In this episode, it's no fluff, no waffle, it's down to business with the host of Microsoft Mechanics and the director of Microsoft 365 himself, Jeremy Chapman, as he takes us on a deep learning journey inside Copilot for Microsoft 365. And this episode really is the definitive learning guide. Stay tuned, you're not going to want to miss this. Greetings, fellow YouTubers. How are you? Welcome to the channel, especially if this is your first visit. Before we start, I've got to reach out to every one of you and say a huge thank you for supporting me on my journey into YouTube. In fact, 100,000 thank yous. I've just got my silver award and I really, really do appreciate your support. So thank you for that. Okay, now on this week's episode, Jeremy Chapman joins me once again for the third and final interview in the series that I've been doing. And in this episode, it's the definitive guide for Copilot for Microsoft 365. Now, the big news this week, of course, is that the 300 purchase limit no longer exists. So now we have a brand new version of Copilot and it currently comes in three flavors. So there's kind of a free version that comes with the Edge browser, and we've got Copilot Pro for Microsoft 365, small and medium-sized businesses. And then of course, you've got Copilot for Microsoft 365 Enterprise, and that announcement was made just a month or so ago. Now, super exciting, and I'm so excited to welcome again Jeremy, who's going to join us, and he's going to tell you all about it. So really cool stuff. Now, if you haven't subscribed to the channel, then please go ahead, support me by bumping that subscribe button, ring that bell, and come and join our great learning community. And if you have questions and comments, by all means, just get them down below. And if you want to support me a little bit more and get some more, then why not sign up to my Patreon site and have a look at the various membership levels that I offer. Details are just there. So I think without any further ado, let me once again introduce my very good friend and colleague at Microsoft in Redmond, Jeremy Chapman, host of Microsoft Mechanics and the director himself of Microsoft 365. Jeremy, it's great to see you once again. Hey, Jeremy, it's fantastic to see you again. I've not seen you for ages, actually.
Yeah, it's been a long time. It's been a big year, actually. I think last time we talked, it was probably in the early days of Copilot. And today's, you know, this year of 2023 has really been about kind of the year of the large language model and Copilot and generative AI. So there's a lot to share here.
Absolutely. And I've done a few conferences this year and everybody wants to know about Copilot. And I think I feel like it's something that I've been missing and I'm getting so many questions on. So I thought in this session we could have a really nice kind of deep dive and what it is, how to prepare your business for Microsoft 365 Copilot. So we're really excited that you're joining us. So awesome.
Thanks, Andy. You know, one of the things I want to do, and one of the things that I kind of have as a benefit of doing Microsoft Mechanics is that I not only see all the content from like Microsoft 365, but I also see the content from Azure and Search and the data and AI team and even like Dynamics and everyone else. And I know kind of how all these different pieces fit together. So what I wanted to do is actually kind of walk through, you know, some of the aspects of Copilot, how they relate to Copilots with a lowercase c that you can build. So I can kind of maybe demystify some of the elements as part of the kind of workflows involved and the automation involved for the parts that you don't see once you hit kind of enter on your prompt.
That sounds awesome. That's exactly what we want to see.
All right. So what I want to do actually is I want to start with a demonstration. So I'll go ahead and we'll start out with, this is something I actually recorded yesterday based on our chats that we had. So first off, I wanted to have Copilot basically summarize our email thread together. So basically I'm asking it to summarize my most recent email thread with you, with Andy Malone. And then, so what that's going to do once I submit that is it's going in and it's looking across different data sources. So it knows, for example, that this data is actually an email, it's an Outlook. So it can go and find our most recent emails and it can basically say, okay, because I have this connection that I have permission to the Microsoft graph, I can actually go and find the different various emails that you and I have exchanged. And it's basically summarizing that content for me. So it knew where to get the information. It parsed that information. And now it's presenting that back to me, which is great, by the way, if you, especially coming back from the holidays. If you haven't been on email for a couple of weeks and you want to say, geez, what was that thing I promised Andy 2 weeks ago? Because it's out of my mind. This is perfect for something like that. The nice thing is now also as part of this, and you'll see there's a general label, even the labels and those types of things are presented to you. And we'll get back to that in a few minutes, but all those compliance controls are there as well. And again, this is only data that I had access to explicitly.
Okay. Now, so how does it work? You're gonna, we see the front end. How does Copilot work at the back end then?
Yeah, so you know, we've done a lot of work on mechanics. We kind of started out showing how these things work a few months back, and I'll just go through that at a very, very high level, and then I want to go through it a little bit deeper. So at a very high level, when you think about how these things work, first, you know, Copilot for Microsoft 365, it's a service, and you can think about it like it comprises all these different things. First, large language models. It has that access to the Microsoft graph that I talked about. Internet for grounding, if you've ever seen like date cutoffs, that gets solves for that. The graph is nice though because it has like all of your message content, your calendar, the files that you have in SharePoint and OneDrive, all your meetings, chats, those types of things. So when you do a search like I did for you in that case, it actually parsed that information. It could then format that and send a version of that along with my prompt to the large language model, so it could basically formulate an informed response and then put that back into the chat experience for Microsoft Copilot. So that's how that just worked. Oh yeah, but it's actually a little bit more complicated than that. So I'm guessing that you've seen this image before.
I was going to say. I was just going to say. Can you? How does the architecture of it actually work? How does it work in the back end? So that was going to be my next question, actually.
Yeah, so you know, if I'll use my cursor here as the rude way of going through it, but I'm going to go through this a bit more step by step as well. So first off, your prompt comes in. It goes through the Copilot orchestration service. Now the orchestration service, basically at first, and this is kind of our step one, it says, okay, I see the prompt, and I need to process that prompt. And there's a few things that it does there, but it needs to interpret what you're asking. Then it can go and find basically information. So the first step that it can go and look for is it can find information if it needs to from the web, from plugins, if you've got those wired up, and it can also go to the Microsoft graph. And the graph, by the way, can be extended using graph connectors. Then it can find the information that it needs effectively. And this is all, again, based on the information that you explicitly have access to again. And it sends that information then back to a large language model. Now, the large language model here will basically take the information of your prompt and then the hidden information that was kind of retrieved as part of the retrieval process from the graph or plugins or graph connectors, et cetera, and then present that to the large language model, which then responds back. That then traverses back to the graph and it says, okay, so maybe there's different information protection or data security controls that need to be applied, labels, things like that presented back to the user. So it can interpret all of that. You can see it's here as part of the compliance with purview controls. That then gets sent back up and then it goes and gets filtered one more time through responsible AI, all the stuff here, and sent back to Copilot.
Okay, so that sounds cool. And what about things like the kind of the prompts themselves? Can we customize them? Can customers customize them themselves for their organization? Is that a simple thing to do?
Yeah, I think that. So I think the best way to explain this, and I'm going to deviate a bit from Copilot for Microsoft 365. And again, use my exposure to the Azure AI Studio and that process with things like prompt flows and the different content filtering, et cetera, there. Because I think that actually visually explains it even more if you want to go that next level of depth. So Let me go back and I'll show you kind of the way the flow looks with some demonstrations as well in terms of what that kind of looks like in action.
Cool.
So, okay. So I've again, unbranded this. This is no longer Copilot for Microsoft 365. This is if you built your own bot, but a lot of the concepts are still similar. So here it starts out with your user prompt. So the user prompt is going to go in. It's going to get the first round of content filters, and then it's basically going to go in through the orchestration layer, which is represented kind of like we just basically replaced the logos here, icons here, and then it's going to go to a process that's called grounding. Now, the first step in grounding is actually something called a system message. You might hear of it as a system prompt or a meta prompt. You may have used this either in, you know, like in ChatGPT, there are things where you can describe yourself, your profession, your interests, those types of things. That's basically a system message or system prompt. So what happens then is basically that gives it more context. So let me just show you how that looks inside the AI Studio. So you start out with a very simple prompt, and that's kind of the default system message that you get. They give you prompt samples that you can append to it as well. So then, for example, if I want to do a marketing writing assistant, which is still a pretty basic system message, but it gives all that different information about kind of what it is, the context. You could say, I want to, you know, build Airbnb sites and listings or those types of things, or vacation rentals, or, you know, or you can give it like the book of law, basically. As long as you stay within your token limits, you can give it enough information where it's got a ton of context. So that's your first step. So that's kind of like giving it the system message to say, like, you're not only a co-pilot, but you also need to abide by these different rules, cite your sources, be nice, be friendly, don't be mean, all of those types of things that you might put in that system message. Then you need to wire in your data, assuming that not all the data is either in the large language model training set from when it was last trained, which, you know, for GPT-4 might be a few months back. For GPT-3.5, it might go as far back as like September 2021. I remember my first encounter, I was trying to look up movies from ChatGPT around this time last year, and it was giving me recommendations from like a year and a half before. And I was like, no, that's not playing in the cinema anymore. Like, that's because there's a training cutoff, and that's why you need web content for grounding. Yeah. Even on GPT-4, where it's more frequently updated, the training set's still going to be a few months behind the times, effectively. So that's why web comes in. Okay. So basically, then you have the ability to give it more data as part of retrieval, to look at the web, to look at any kind of connected information, if you have plugins. And the plugins for, you know, Copilot, by the way, work with the ChatGPT-style plugins. And then if you're using, again, your own Copilot or building your own, you're going to have data that you probably want to wire up against it, which can be documents, databases, files, search indexes, those types of things. Because what we have to do is we basically take the prompt in. We're going to look at the intent of that prompt. We're going to translate that into a query, effectively, more machine translated effectively, so it can go and find the information that it needs. And then retrieve that information. It's always still going to respect the user permissions that you assign to that data, because it's going to parse all the same auth effectively through all those different steps based on the user that's in that session. So what that looks like then is if I play this one through and I wire up some data. So here, for example, I'm going to add data, a data source. I'm not adding the Microsoft graph, obviously, because this is my own private Copilot, lowercase c. And I can add, say, a search index, blob storage files, as you saw. And so here we can do things like use AI search. And the nice thing with this is if I've already got an instance of it configured, I can basically select the one I want, and I can select the search index that I have. So I'm going to go ahead and add one for my manuals, because I've got a store here that sells tents and outdoor supplies and things. And this can use vector search. Now, if you're unfamiliar with vector search, it's basically calculating like coordinates based on parts or fragments of sentences, chunks, as we call them, or images themselves. Well, it turns out that keyword search plus vector search gives you the best results. So you want that, plus we do something called re-ranking at the end, which basically says if you want a specific part number, I can find that because it's going to be exact text string, or if you describe, I want that thing that steers my car, it's going to know you're talking about a steering wheel, and it'll be able to infer that from the chunk of the sentence that you're implying. So now I've got my data source wired up against my Copilot here, again, lowercase c. And so if I ask it about information that's held in this index for Contoso manuals, these are the manuals to like set up tents and stuff, and I say, tell me about all the different tents that I have in my catalog, then I let that basically chew on that. It's going to go out and it's going to search the data that I wired up. So it's basically going through that Azure AI search process and the index. It's looking for all the different tents that we have in the catalog. And this is all real time, so I didn't speed anything up. That's why. Okay, there we go. And it finds my four different tents. So that way it answers my question. This is information specific to me that's not on the web in our case, because it's used my private data in this case. So that's basically how it did the information retrieval from my own data source. Now, again, this is not the Microsoft graph, but it's kind of serving the same type of function as a repo of data where it can go and retrieve information.
Sure. No, very powerful. Extremely.
So then the next thing is basically, okay, so now I've retrieved the information, and all these different automation processes are happening behind the scenes. And anybody that's kind of like thinking, why does it take so long for the prompt to respond? Well, all these things are happening behind the scenes. So then it's basically taking that information. It's kind of processing that. Sometimes it's got to make sure that it, again, stays within the token limits of what it can present to the LLM, because it might hit a character count limit for some cases. It's got to then send that to the large language model, which the large language model gets effectively that retrieved information plus all of the prompt information that you had. Then it can return its response. So kind of similar to what we saw before in the Copilot example. And now, just because I'm a kind of an automation nerd, and I kind of grew up doing a lot of task sequencing and all the things that are kind of now known as like Power Automate and logic apps and kind of similar stuff. It's doing something like that with what we call prompt flows in the AI Studio to basically run a series of different steps or tasks against that input. So you start out with your base prompt, and your base prompt, it's got to then determine what do you actually want. So here we have a bit of a larger system prompt, but it can determine based on what you sent it, exactly what it wants to do. It extracts the intent of your natural language, builds that into a proper query that it can go and use for retrieval. So it's going to use that to basically retrieve documents and format those into the right form, so it can actually, again, do it in a very kind of streamlined way. But if we go back to our retrieval steps, you can see that we're doing a search. We're also doing search based on both keywords as well as vector search queries too. So we're doing semantic search as well. Then we can take what it returns back with, format the response into text so that we can then process it. And all of this, by the way, so that everything the user sees is just kind of seeing, you know, very minimal UX. So this is kind of the what's seen versus the stuff that's kind of hidden in the background, which is all the stuff on the right. That point, it needs to determine the reply. So this is the more developed system message. This is what you'd use if you built something that might be a global service where you're saying, like, here are safety things you need to abide by, citations for all your sources, all of that stuff. So if you're building a more complex and more globally kind of user-friendly system or Copilot effectively, that's the kind of longer prompt you tend to want to use. And it basically converts that into the output, and the user just gets that simple response like we saw before with the tents, where it's just a few paragraphs of context.
Okay, cool.
Yeah. So then the last step basically is that, and we had as the first step and the last step, is that Copilot sends that back through. It's got the formatted response, but it has to run it through a content filter. And we hear the term responsible AI, and it means a lot of things. And I'll just give you a portion of what that means. So in Azure AI Studio, it lets you actually build these content filters in. So for example, if you go into content filters, you can create one, and basically you can see the types of categories that we're actually filtering for. So if anybody asks, like, what are we actually filtering for from a responsibility standpoint, you know, we want to make sure that all these types of categories, both on the input side and the output side, are kind of monitored and or filtered out. And then we also want to make sure if somebody's trying to break the mechanism of the Copilot or the system that you put in place, or find copyright material, those types of things, that we can also detect that. So these are all the things that we're doing when we say, like, what are these filters that are added so that the user doesn't get in trouble and that you're not kind of presenting a bad result. So this is part of what AI Studio does for you to basically kind of help direct and guide that output.
Yeah, I was going to ask, I mean, obviously, security and compliance are like super important. So obviously, the next step is, you know, how does it deal with the compliance side of it? Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. So that's part of what I showed in the first, and let me just go back to that view again. So the first shot that we saw, we basically had, it was able to access graph and compliance and purview controls effectively. And if we look at, for example, some of the new things that we've added recently, it's first the ability to display labels. So again, these are all contents that you have access to. But let's say you do find or use a document that has a confidential label on it. Well, we'll actually in context display that label to you just so you know that this prompt that you're using is referencing a file that has a label on it that's confidential in this case or highly confidential. And that way you see that. The other thing that's nice is, let's say you're in the context like here of Word and you want to reference a file, say to here, generate a short FAQ, summarize it. Well, the nice thing is we actually will inherit the label that was applied to the reference material. So automatically you'll see the sensitivity of the file get marked effectively with the right label based on the reference material that it used. And if you're just using it to write content from scratch, just like you would if you copied and pasted or, you know, wrote everything by hand with your keyboard, any content that's generated and that you keep in the document will automatically trigger that label, just like it would for auto labeling for anything that you do, because basically that document's getting scanned in real time. And in our case, we had a keyword set up for an exact data match for the word obsidian. It's not used that often, which is a good code name then. So then when obsidian is detected, it basically automatically applies that label.
Okay, very good. You know, that's going to kind of put people's minds at rest, definitely. Just general question, what if I don't have any of this set up? And obviously we're thinking about kind of moving to Copilot. What do I need to do in order to kind of get things set up?
Yeah, so all of this really, when you think about it, the main things that you want to do, and first it kind of hinges on what's called just enough access or least privilege. Like, you never want to over-permission anyone. Like, this is with or without Copilot, by the way. You never want to over-permission content in general to people. And if people have access to that content, not only can Copilot find it, but you can find it through search. You can go into SharePoint search or Microsoft365.com. search for that data and find that stuff that you may not or should not have access to. Yeah. So that's the first thing. So that, like, the easiest way to do auto labeling in this case, because you saw that with purview controls, basically we're always looking for an attribute, a trait for the file, whether that's like a document class, trainable document classifier, or a sensitive information type. And you've probably seen all those with, you know, DLP rules with credit cards and ID numbers and passports. Yeah. And all those things. And then we just did exact data match for the word obsidian, or we could do that through communication compliance with keyword search as well. But one of the easiest things that you can do if you just want to have quickly the right labels applied and the right policies is just to say at a container level. So, like, let's say your entire human resources team works in a specific set of SharePoint sites or document libraries. You can automatically label at a container level the files that are there. So if someone who's not in the HR team that was over permission, maybe somebody did a bunch of share with everyone type links in the past for those HR files and you could have found them in search, well, guess what? Copilot will be able to find them too if I can find it in search. So that way, if those documents are labeled and you kind of are restricting the radius of sharing through everything in those containers, that's the easiest way, I would say, to be able to limit the access to those files. Of course, there are other things that you can do, like SharePoint site audits and make sure that not everyone in the company is a member, those types of things, so that you have the right memberships and the right sites and document libraries so that only those people have access. But then you can do auto labeling and apply protections based on the containers that those files are in as kind of your next level safety net. Again, trying to get to just enough access, least privilege, so that you don't expose too much content through search.
Yeah. So I suppose I should ask about kind of, you know, now we've set it up, what about auditing? What kind of controls can I put in place kind of to just make sure everything's kind of kosher there.
Right, of course. So this is a Microsoft 365 service. So you would expect all of the logging and auditing to be there, regardless of whether that's through Copilot or email or Teams or anything else. So we've actually got all of that built in also. So for example, if you're using tools like Communication Compliance and Purview, of course, everything there will show up. So here, for example, we're looking at the different Copilot subjects that are in that have been basically found for the word Obsidian in our case, like I mentioned. And so all of that will show up through your normal Content Explorer and different search mechanisms because it's all logged and audited and basically using the same messaging system that you'd use for Teams or an email. And so you can also use the right for locations if you add Teams or different messages to it for the different Teams chats. You can have all of this, make sure that your policies apply, you know, from a communication compliance perspective to Copilot conversations. And then if we think about like sensitive information types, so anything from a DLP policy perspective, and you're seeing communication compliance here, you can do things like add different conditions as to how that document can be shared, or if there are different conditions like limit the sharing radius, or you know, make sure that it only stays with the creator of the file. Those types of things can be applied in DLP or like you saw communication compliance for detection rules that you have. For data lifecycle, for things like retention, you can use it. You can use retention policies to set up retention against different Copilot conversations and sessions that you have here.
Okay, so I suppose I should ask, I mean, everybody's going to want to know this. As an IT pro, how do I get started? How do I learn about it? How do I educate my users about it? I mean, they're bound to have thousands of questions about this.
Yeah, and I've done a lot of work on this as well personally and working with a lot of different teams over the last year to make sure that we've got some great both guidance as well as, you know, some wizards and things in the admin center as well that you'll use in Microsoft 365. So let me just show you a couple things first in terms of getting everything up and running. So first, your Office client apps or the Microsoft 365 apps for enterprise need to be on the right channel. As of December, by the way, the monthly enterprise channel will work. Prior to that, you would have needed the current channel, but monthly enterprise channel is fine. As you know, like some of the semi-annual channels, there's a lot of lag in terms of the features going into those products. So you want to be on a relatively recent channel. Sure. And of course, it works for things like some of the more aggressive rings if you're doing, you know, insider testing, et cetera. And then from a licensing perspective, Copilot license assigned. And then if we look at the portal itself in the admin center, we've actually added some new resources for admins to get everything configured. So the nice thing is you can basically set up all your own security and compliance policy. Some of the stuff I showed before in Purview, we link to all of that stuff for you. If you go into the add-ons and kind of plugins and those types of things for extensibility, you can determine, the nice thing is if you connect data to it, you can determine down to the user or group who has access to that plugged in data or connected data through graph connectors. You can also determine whether or not you want to use web content. So web content is one of those things where, again, if you want to be able to get content that's current past that or newer than that cutoff date for knowledge for the training of the LLM, this gives you that ability to be able to call that content, and you have the control. If you can't do it, if it's kind of against your own regulation or policy, you can turn it off here as well. And so then the next question, like you mentioned, like, how do I make sure that my users are actually doing it, using it, and getting value out of it? Well, a few things that we've done first, and this is something if you know Caruana and team, like she's worked a lot with her team on the adoption aspects of getting Copilot up and running. And so all the content there for how to prepare for it, how it works, like setting up a community, a kind of a center of excellence. The Copilot Lab content is built into the products, so you can actually get hints or pointers as to what types of prompts to use as a new user. And you can go in and view prompts, and this is both an in-product experience as well as a website. So if you want to know like some of the things that you can do right now to kind of save time and give you nice results, you can do it there. If you click on the link to go to the website, it actually gives you personal recommendations. These are all like featured prompts, things that you can actually filter and try out based on the different apps that you're using as entry points, the different categories that you want to use with your prompts. So all of that is covered here. But even beyond that, like just best practices as well as part of how to write prompts. And these are things that you should as kind of an application owner be able to convey with your users, like make sure that you're being specific with your prompts and how to do that. And, you know, those types of habits as to how to ask questions and get the right answers to have the best results. And then the last thing is like, am I getting value out of it? Well, that's something new that we've built as well that's currently in Viva Insights. But basically it will say like, how are people actually using it across the different apps and experiences? What's our adoption look like across all of our apps? But also based on the different features that we have, you know, how's the impact in our organization? What does that look like? And then different, you know, news and other support articles and documentation that you can read to help in terms of getting value from it. And so that actually installs as a Power BI app as part of Viva Insights, as mentioned. And you'll see more functionality over time coming as well to the Microsoft 365 Admin Center.
Cool. Very nice. Very good. Okay. Well, thanks so much for joining me today, Jeremy. I really appreciate your insights into Microsoft Copilot, as does my audience. We'll put all the links down below. And of course, definitely visit Jeremy on Microsoft Mechanics. You can find him there on most days. I think they let him out now and again.
We've done a bunch of content on all the different Copilots. So we can put the link on the screen there. I think it's ak.ms/m365 Copilot Mechanics. But yeah, everything that you probably want to know, and maybe then some, if you want to go into some of the Azure topics, we've covered that and we're going to keep going.
Perfect. Awesome. Okay. Thanks so much for joining me. I really appreciate it, Jeremy. Cheers.
Thank you.
So there you have it, host of Microsoft Mechanics and the director himself of Microsoft 365. Okay, you can't go any higher than that. I really hope that you enjoyed this episode, and if you did, bomb that subscribe button, ring that bell, and come and join my great learning community here. Questions, comments, as always, just get those down below, and as always, I'll do my best for you. That's it for today. Thanks so much for joining me. I'll see you next time. Take care. Hey, thanks so much for dropping by today. Here's a couple of videos that you may enjoy. And while you're here, go ahead, click on the subscribe button and you won't miss out.